Playboy architecture, like the project that you were talking about before, like the radical pedagogies, is part of this project that I have been conducting in the last few years, collaborative research project with my PhD students at Princeton University. So the project, in fact, is the culmination of at least 4 years of research on Playboy in the School of Architecture, a series of seminars I led and workshops that started with the simple, really, really simple, almost a stupid realization that there was a lot of Playboy, a lot of architecture in Playboy magazine. Now you have to understand that Playboy, everybody knows that it's full of literature, music, all these politics, really very philosophy, really very interesting magazine, but and everybody knows that, but nobody seems to have realized that there was so much architecture in it. Now, you may be surprised that of why a university like Princeton will be interested in Playboy, and indeed you have to have seen the faces, or the look at least, in the faces of the librarians that fall when they ask me what did I need for bibliography in my class, and I say to them, buy the entire run of Playboy, and they look at me like I was making a joke or something, and of course weeks pass and they haven't done it, and like, okay, I asked for a very specific thing. So I have to repeat it like 3 times before finally they got the point. Now, already in the 50s, there was this saying that people read Playboy for the articles. And, you know, it seems like a joke, but it's not, because when you look at the magazine closely, it's extraordinary in this respect. You see interviews with, fabulous interviews with Marsha McLuhan, with Jean-Paul Sartre, Salvador Dalí, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, Fidel Castro. I mean, really gets political too. You have great writers like Ray Bradbury, for example, Fahrenheit 451 was serialized in the magazine in 1954 before it was published as a book. There is Allen Ginsberg, Jack Kerouac, and the whole Beat Generation, John Apatow, Doris Lessing, Hemingway, Italo Calvino, Henry Miller, Nadine, I mean, you name it. Any author that you think of this moment is in the magazine. But you also found from the very beginning that the magazine, and this is much less well known, as I say, covered, and they were based in Chicago, at the beginning they covered Fran Jorroy, they covered Miss Van der Rohe, they have articles on them, but then they slowly move also through the 50s crowd of IMSA, Rinen, Bertoia, etc., to practically echo all the major developments of the 1960s and 70s, from Charles Moore to Ant Farn to Bucky Fuller to Paolo Soleri to Moses Safdie. They mean the report on the new domestic landscape, they know about Colombo, they know everything, right? So the interest also for of Playboy for architecture and design is, by the way, already evident in this first issue with Marilyn Monroe in the cover and the promise of her naked body inside. You know that this is the first issue, and Hefner was not sure that this was going to work. So he didn't even, you know, this is a reprint. They didn't even put number one in the cover because they didn't know that there was going to be a number two. So that's how crazy the thing. And of course, they sold 64,000 copies. And very important to that was that Hefner had bought this calendar picture. It was supposed to be in a calendar, and it was never included in the calendar. And she bought it for quite a bit of money, actually. And that's what he put in the centerfold of the magazine. So, as I say, in this very issue, there is already architecture. This is actually the first editorial page, and you can see already there is architecture, modern architecture and design, in the editorial. So, just to put the clear basis before we go any further, architecture and sexuality are really inseparable from the beginning of Playboy magazine. Second point, architecture is not something covered in the magazine, like literature, politics, and all these things we have talked about, but is integral to it. That is, the sexual fantasies and the architectural fantasies are inseparable. There is no sex without architecture, not architecture without sex. And finally, Playboy cannot exist without architecture. Moreover, as the title already indicates, with the total interior, this architecture is all about the interior. The Playboy, and the editorial board already, the editorial page already tells you, is an indoor man. The first editorial already says, we don't mind telling you in advance that we plan on spending most of our time inside. We like our apartments. We enjoy mixing cocktails and an hors d'oeuvre or two, putting a little mood music on the phonograph and inviting a female acquaintance for a quiet discussion on Picasso, Nietzsche, jazz, or sex. So now you have the whole combination of this interior world, right, in which there is also a lot of culture, Picasso, jazz, literature, Nietzsche, that we are going to discuss in the magazine. This philosophy is embedded in the figure. So the Playboy is an indoors man, as you have seen, right? They like the, his apartment. They like, we like our apartment, right? We are going to spend a lot of time inside. So he's an indoors man, clearly. But we may want to stop a little bit in why we don't mind telling you in advance. What is it that this means? Why they don't mind? What is there to mind? And the editorial is clear in that sense too, when they write that most other magazines for men spend all their time outdoors, thrashing through thorny thickets or splashing about in fast-flowing streams. We'll be out there too occasionally, but we don't mind telling you in advance that we plan to spend most of our time inside. So, of course, the language is also very sexual, you know, thrashing through thorny thickets or splashing about in fast-flowing streams. So, in contrast to all the shelter magazines, let's say, the House Beautiful, House and Garden, etc., etc., they magazines for men were magazines about the outdoors, no, about fishing or about, I don't know, doing something outside, definitely never inside. And the Playboy is claiming the interior in a way for mom. So most magazines spend all this time outside, but the Playboy is clearly a different kind of animal. He's also a hunter, but the metropolitan apartment is his natural habitat. He knows everything about it and keeps adjusting this apartment, as you can see even in this thing, to better catch his prey. In fact, as you will see, he cares much more about the lure than the catch. It is the apartment itself that is the ultimate object of desire. The Playboy and his magazines are all about architecture. This philosophy, as I say, is already embodied in the figure of Hefner himself, who famously almost never left his bed, let alone his house. He literally moved his office to his bed in 1960 when he moved into the Playboy Mansion in Chicago, turning it into the epicenter of a global empire and his silk pajamas and his dressing gown into a kind of business attire. Here he is in bed, as you can see, working in bed with all the images around, with all the editorials on the phone, the food is around. He's not moving from the bed. It's all these great pictures. Even before he moved his offices to the mansion, he already had developed a method of work that seemed to be always working on the floor or on the carpet. I mean, always like everything is on the floor, so it seems like a natural movement. And you can already see that he's already surrounded by modern furniture. I don't go out of the house at all. I am a contemporary recluse, he said to Tom Wolfe that had come to interview him, guessing that the last time he had been out of the house had been 3.5 months before, and that in the last 3 years he had been out of the house only 9 times. Fascinated, Wolfe described him as the tender timpani greenheart of an artichoke. And here you have more pictures of Hefner in bed and the famous book of Tom Wolfe, where there is this text. He had interviewed Hefner, of course, Hefner being in bed, and this is when he says that he never goes out of the house at all. But what is interesting too is that when Hefner actually went out, he was not out at all, but wrapping a succession of bubbles, as if he were, all the signs trying to extend the interior, the specially outfitted vehicles, of which the Big Bunny is probably the most interesting one. This is a stretch DC9 that was designed, interior designed by Ron Dearsmith. Ron Dearsmith was also the architect of the mansion, and it included, listen to this, a gourmet kitchen, a dancing floor, a living room, conference space, a discotheque, a wet bar, a state-of-the-art cinemascope projectors, a sleeping quarters for 16 guests. And this is the plan of the plane, and of course Hefner's suite with a shower and an elliptical bed covering Tasmanian opossum skins. And here is the suite of Hefner, and here is Hefner with his then girlfriend Barbie arriving in Heathrow Airport. So he's really not moving, he's just going from one bubble to a house, to a car, to the plane, to another club. Because of course there is also the home away from home of the Playboy clubs, starting with the Playboy Club in Chicago of 1960 and rapidly moving through seven play clubs in 1963, 17 in 65, and ultimately 33 clubs. Playboy is produced in a radical interior and is devoted to the interior. This is, for example, New Orleans, and this is Miami. So Playboy is produced in an interior and is dedicated to the interior, dedicated, you may say, even like a lover. The magazine is full of interiors from the very first issue. Also, it's very interesting to see that Hefner himself pictures himself as an architect. Look at these photographs of him with the model of the club of LA that was never finally realized this way. But there he is with his pipe, as if looking at the model as if he was, you know, Le Corbusier, which is a photograph, a similar image that he probably knew with the pipe and the model, or these other images of, you know, architects and their models. So it's like if he fashioned himself as an architect too. Not only is the magazine full of interiors, but no detail of domestic space is left untouched, from the furniture to the lighting to the hi-fi and the dress code, the shoes, the robes, everything is provided. You have, for example, here these pages that became now are typical of lifestyle magazines, where they recommend the things that you can buy for Christmas or for anything, no? And that, of course, include a lot of design objects, but also a lot of hi-fi equipment, which is very important for Playboy, and shoes, and of course, how not, the robe, which is where the Playboy is supposed to spend a lot of his time, is a very important thing. And also the mixing of a good martini is also a very important thing. In this particular article, I think the role of Playboy in design becomes even more obvious when the issue provides this guide to the 25 steps that are necessary for a successful conquest. And as you can see, it's like a play on the on the movements of the rational houses, that is completely irrational, the movements of seduction includes a lot of step backwards and forward. But what is interesting is that the sequence is mapped in a modern apartment, as if the layout and the equipment itself were choreographing the dance of seduction. And as the Playboy maneuvers his prey towards the bed, each detail of the apartment seems to assist in the movement. Not by chance, the journey starts precisely with the lightweight curves of the butterfly chair and the deep sensuous folds of Eros Aladinen warm chair, which are both, by the way, signature chairs in Playboy. Here, already in the editorial, you saw the Hardoy chair. And you see many of those chairs in the magazine, with all the the bunnies lounging as if the chair was a kind of portable house. You see all these examples, and likewise, and again more, And again, the Saarinen chair is another signature chair of Playboy that appears in the covers, but also you see, playmates lounging in Saarinen chairs. It is, in a way, as if the designers were in the room of the seduction, assisting in the seduction. And in fact, this is an image that you may know today from Design Without Living, because they adopted this image. But it was an article in Playboy magazine, an article in which they talk about these contemporary designers. And each one of them is presented here with their chairs, Nelson, Saarinen, Eames, etc., or Bertoia, all with their chairs. The Playboy, and how knowledgeable they were is also very interesting, because I thought, how did they get to the point in which the play of seduction starts with the Hardoy chair and the Saarinen chair? And then with the students at Princeton, we start looking at how the Lakeshore Drive apartments were first presented in the press, and we came up with this image. So one of the first images of occupation in the Lakeshore Drive apartments, I thought it would be Mies chairs or something like this, no? But no, this all mid-50s furniture, and it's precisely these two chairs that are the iconic kind of chairs of this moment. So far from producing an array of seductive images, Playboy analyzes the architecture of seduction. It offers a kind of user manual to the reader. And in the end, the sophisticated Playboy needs to know more about modern design than about woman. It's not that there are articles about the psychology of woman and whether you should be doing this or that. There are these articles like this in which they tell you that it's very important, for example, that the bar will be, so they advocate the open plan. Why? Because you have the bar and the couch, and now you have the lady sitting in the couch, and you don't want to disappear into the kitchen, and, you know, behind. So you want to be keeping eye contact constantly, because if you go to the kitchen and you come back, you may find that she has put on her coat and her handbag in hand, and it has changed her mind about the whole thing, and the whole thing is over, right? So modern architecture is really very necessary for seduction, because you need all this space. So it's all about design. They are not talking at all about what a woman wants or doesn't want. It's about how, you know, so you have to be an expert in design, not an expert in women. But in any case, everything in Playboy seems to be done through the lens of design. Even a spoof on psychoanalysis of a detailed drawing of the couch and a plan of the room, etc. Likewise, the movements of the furniture are broken down, as are the precise movements of the martini production that we saw before. Playboy relentlessly dissects each dimension of the interior. Now, this dedication to the interior culminates in the September 1956 issue with the Playboy penthouse, which is the first Playboy design apartment, which is, I'm presenting here the cover so that you can see how innocent these covers are still, right? So 56 is the third year of the magazine. And in this year, they present this Playboy, what they call a Playboy pad, which is a Playboy design apartment. And as you can see, lavishly illustrated in an 8-page spread, which is longer than anything they have done before, and continue with another 6 pages in the next issue of October, were rejecting the convention in which they say the overwhelming percentage of homes is furnished by women. The point was precisely to create an interior that is unambiguously masculine, with equipment that stays and, of course, women that come and go. And that's what they say. A man yearns for quarters of his own. More than a place to hang his hat, a man dreams of his own domain, a place that is exclusively his. Playboy has designed, planned, and decorated from the floor up a penthouse apartment for the urban bachelor. So what are they reacting against? They are reacting to what many articles, not just Playboy, but also Life magazine and others, call the feminization of America, with all these shelter magazines and the suburbanization of America. Playboy is urban, and all these other magazines and advocating life in the suburbs, and are you know, the women are the ones in charge of the decoration of these houses, etc. So what Playboy does is to claim interior design and decoration as a, you know, for men as well, right? So that you have this kind of atmospheric renderings that conjure a landscape of entertainment, each one described in great detail, as you can see, giving you all the detail of all the furniture, the lamps, the null cabinets, the imps and sarinen chairs, the noguchi table, all the equipment of the kitchen. It continues in the next issue, again, the noguchi table, the imps chairs. They tell you how much they cost, where you can buy them, etc., etc. The house is also full of the latest electronics and media signature piece. In all the themes of the Playboy is always the entertainment center with hi-fi, FM, radio, TV, tape recorder, movie, and slide projectors. The entire environment can be controlled from the bed. That's very important, which is the epicenter of this idealized interior. But in fact, the occupant of the space, you can say, is the reader. In a canny seduction, the magazine describes the most advanced interior architecture design for a man, they say, perhaps very much like you. So the reader sees himself implicated in this and is, in a way, the client, and is offered even the keys of the apartment in the first page of the article. But this is the funny thing about this this thing, and I don't think they expected this to happen. Architecture, 3 years into the magazine, turned out to be much more seductive than the Playmates. The penthouse front feature was the most popular of any articles in the magazine's history to date, surpassing even the centerfolds. So architecture became, in a way, the ultimate Playmate, the only one that is not allowed to, that is allowed to stay. Playboy received hundreds of letters requesting more information on the house, asking more details of the house, plans, and where to buy the furniture, etc., etc. For example, here, penthouse apartment. We have just finished reading the article on Playboy penthouse in September, blah, blah, blah. You have outdone yourself. We cannot begin to describe the excitement we feel. All we know is that we wish to do something about it. We have long dreamed of building such an apartment. Please send us more information. Before we burst with excitement. So again, excitement is a big word here. Who was the architect? Where is it located? Can we duplicate it in Atlanta as soon as possible, right? And then the other ones in the right, my husband and I, which demonstrated that a lot of women were also reading the magazine, are extremely excited over your September issue. Blah, blah, blah. There are so many ideas, or I'm very interested in the equipment, and could you give me more details about it? Other people are interested in this. So it was so successful that Playboy started a series of features on Playboy pads, which include the weekend hideaway that you can see here of 1959, and very important, the Playboy house of 1962, which was originally commissioned to be a house for Hefner, but they couldn't get it past the landmark commission in Chicago, because of course it's in a very conservative neighborhood, and instead they published it in the magazine, and you have this kind of Paul Rudolph townhouse, right, with the pool here. It reminds me also a little bit of the Josephine Baker house, where the visitor can look into the pool to the people swimming in their naked bodies. And as you can see again, the furniture is always modern, and they also give you the details of where to buy, how much it costs, who is the designer, etc. Then there was, and again, a series of letters immediately after the publication. I want to compliment you for running the article on the Playboy townhouse. It is a very sophisticated, attractive, modern solution to in-town living. In the past, Playboy has provided its readers with the Playboy house and the weekend hideaway. I have always admired the wonderful taste and the elegance of these articles. But in this case, you have outdone yourself. It's not only enjoyable reading, but it's also an outstanding example of blah, blah, blah. So they are all very positive. Now and then you find somebody like this Sandy Jorgensen from Miami, Florida, nobody has ever heard about her, that says, or him, your Playboy townhouse is a wonderful, sleek collection of architectonic clichés, but hardly architecture. Okay, but then you turn around and there is the next letter. And who writes to Playboy? But Richard Neutra, who says that after all, starts the letter by saying, after all kinds of adventures of my own, and after 40 years of skillfully and deftly taking girls through houses, you have given me proof, and then he goes on to say how much he likes his house, but how he himself has designed many modern houses. So basically he's suggesting himself into being presented in Playboy magazine. By the way, Neutra was never in Playboy, but in a way he was trying to push himself into Playboy, that demonstrates that not only he was reading it, but he would have liked to be in Playboy, right? After the townhouse, they did another one, the Playboy patio terrace of 1963, again, like this kind of, the Playboy duplex house of 1970s, again here, and so on. And in each case, the fantasy is the same. The bachelor and his equipments are able to control every aspect of the interior environment to choreograph the successful conquest and subsequent erasure of all the traces in preparation for the next capture. Media equipment is always, as I say, given special attention. There is something that they call at the beginning the electronic entertainment wall, and it's paid a lot of attention in the magazine. And then finally, they call it the Playboy's Wonder Wall, which is also interesting. I did a little bit of research into this and find out that the Wonder Bra was first trademarked in 1955. So they probably wanted to make this association between the Wonder Wall, which is this wall of equipment, and the Wonder Bra, which is the latest kind of bra of the period. Surveillance is, of course, a huge important element here. You have this almost like a Big Brother house. Hefner, in this control room space in his house, can see what is happening in each one of the rooms at any given point. Playboy architecture, nevertheless, turns ultimately on the bed, which becomes increasingly sophisticated, outfitted with all sorts of entertainment and communication devices as a kind of control rooms. This is from the beginning. At the beginning, it's a rectangular bed, but it's also equipped with a lot of this stuff. But very quickly, we go into this round bed, which is precisely the bed of Hefner. This is his famous round bed that was introduced as a feature in the Playboy townhouse in 1962, when it was originally commissioned to be his own house, and then was installed in the Playboy mansion. It's not by chance, by the way, that this is the only piece of the townhouse that is finally realized. The bed itself, you can argue, is a house. It has a rotating and vibrating structure, and it's packed with, listen to this, in a bed: fridge, hi-fi, telephone, filing cabinets, bar, microphone, dictaphone, video cameras, headphones, TV, breakfast table, working tables, and control, of course, for all the lighting in the house. All of this for the man that never wants to leave. The bed was, as we say, literally Hefner's office, his place of business, where he conducted interviews, made phone calls, selected images, adjusted layouts, edited tests, ate, drank, and consulted with playmates. I mean, I say consulted because there is no evidence that he ever had sex with anybody. It's kind of a representation, but there is no real evidence. If Playboy is all about architecture, this architecture is an extension of the bed. The Playboy interior, you can argue, is ultimately and finally all bed. And here you have Hefner in his pajamas working. And I want to show you these images because it's kind of interesting to see the kind of things that he's working on. I don't know whether you can see drug addiction, sex, divorce, abortion. They were in favor of abortion, of birth control, capital punishment, against capital punishment. All those things are still, believe it or not, well, you know perfectly well from the media, very heated topics in the United States. In 53, they were already in favor of birth control and in favor of abortion and against capital punishment. Playboy made it acceptable for men to be interested in modern architecture and design. You were gay if you were interested in modern architecture and design before Playboy made it acceptable. Readers actually were, and this is something that is reinforced in the advertisements, they were encouraged, the readers, to think that they could have a piece of this idealized interior in their own life. So if you could not afford the Playboy townhouse, maybe you could afford a chair by Mies. And in fact, the chair is acting like a kind of portable house again, or the Bertoia house. I mean, they are always like houses, no? And they are occupied this way. So a cycle of desire was built as Playboy kept feeding the fantasy with more and more detail about the objects. And these objects are, of course, by the most sophisticated designers of the day, like Alan Gold or Saarinen, or you know all these beautiful Italian lamps, or golf equipment, or you know the Barcelona chair, and so the Le Corbusier chair, or so many other things that you can see. For example, this is the new domestic landscape with the chairs of the Marite chair of Mata and the Mies chair of Archizum, and they are all presented in and sexualized, obviously, in the magazine. But you have also Ero Arnio and all these inflatable chairs and even equipment. I mean, they gave very good advice. They, you know, you have to buy the Valentina the typewriter or the Colombo. I mean, you would have done very well buying what Playboy told you to buy. In fact, I gave a lecture once in Cornell and a university when I was starting to think about this, and off the cuff, I was not yet thinking about it, but I say I think Playboy may have done more for modern architecture and design than any other architectural magazine or the Museum of Modern Art. And at the end of the lecture, there is this woman that comes to me and says, "Now I understand. Because my father had never went to a museum, knows nothing about architecture." He had the most amazing, he had given her the most amazing collection of modern furniture, and modern chairs, and all these beautiful beautiful things. And so he went and asked him, you know, why did you have all this stuff? And he says, "Playboy told me to buy it." Right? So he ended up with all this this stuff. So in fact, they did a lot in that sense. Well, and the project finishes in the 70s because we thought that this was this was in a way because we went to include Frank Gehry when they spotted these beautiful cardboard chairs of Gehry that they recommend their readers to buy. Those chairs you could buy at that point in Bloomingdale's for $37. Okay, try to buy them right now. So I'm saying they were giving really very good advice. But from that moment on, it starts declining and it has not the same role. In any case, you may be thinking that all this design is a lot more sophisticated than we have seen so far in terms of architecture, and you will be right, but this is about to change when they realize it's not worth for them to start producing, designing these Playboy pads to be represented in the magazine. So they start adopting already existing houses, like this house of Charles Moore in New Haven. Charles Moore, at that point, is the dean of Yale University, right? And it's the New Haven heaven, right? And the New Haven heaven is presented as this kind of heterosexual play pad when the man was gay. But I mean, so it's a little bit perverse, but also think about a dean of America that today will be able to afford in one of these Ivy Leagues to present their apartment in Playboy magazine. Maybe they will get fired the next day, right? So here is the apartment of Charles Moore in Playboy, where, as I say, despite the fact that he was gay, all the images suggest heterosexuality, right? Or you have this house of Matis Ararunen, which is presented as the portable playhouse that you can take to the countryside, or you can take it to the beach, or you can take it to the snow, you can take it anywhere in the world, and of course this all sexualized presented in quite appealing way. Then there is, for example, the John Lobner house. They spotted that house, the Elrod house of 1971. It's interesting that they present these beautiful images with, because, you know, at that point, first of all, architectural magazines were mostly using black and white photographs. They didn't have, Playboy had money. You know, at that point, they had 7 million readers. That is a lot of money. In terms, you can send a good photographer. So they had money to produce all these great images, and they also populate them. Soon afterwards, the same house will be used as a setting in James Bond film Diamonds Are Forever. And of course, another one thing that one could develop here is the relationship between James Bond films and Playboy. In fact, James Bond is himself a Playboy Club member, as you can see here. Other things that were in Playboy magazines were things that would not be in any architectural magazine, so they would have not paid any attention, like this bubble house of Chrysalis in 1972, again in these images, or the Ant Farm house of the century. I don't know whether you know, but how did they knew these things? Is how did they knew these people that really in the cutting edge, really avant-garde architects and artists like the group of Ant Farm is something interesting. So this become like the new Playboy. They call it Playboy paths, but in fact they existed prior to and independently of Playboy. They adopted them as if it were, and then they pay for the photographs, for the models, etc. and etc. So with this move from the design paths by Playboy to the houses they adopt as Playboy paths, there is an increasing sophistication, if you want, in the architecture. It is no longer one or two curvy designer chairs with prop up the comely girl next door at the heart of the Playboy core fantasy, but really fully realized buildings and interiors by leading experimental architects that are shown filled with women that seem to become more sophisticated along with the architecture, as if design was intensifying and somehow elevating the fantasy. Sometimes high-profile architects such as Frank Lloyd or Mies van der Rohe or Bucky Fuller are presented in features and interviews in the magazine as major cultural figures, perfectly dressed and symptomatically celebrated for their masculinity, of their masculine sophistication, with subtle and not so subtle hints that they too are Playboy. For example, in the first year already, Frank Lloyd was praised as an uncommon man who zooms around in his Jaguar, has a controversial love life that was a plus for Playboy, and radical, exciting buildings. So the architect becomes a model, carefully posed at the very heart of the Playboy fantasy. It is as if the architect's dream of the future gets fused with the dream of sexual contest. Here is Mies. They cover Mies when he does the Lakeshore Drive apartment. This is, to understand this context, you have to see, for example, that House Beautiful, in the same year that Playboy started, which is 1953, wrote a terrible article, Elizabeth Gordon, called the Threat to the Next America. And you know what the threat to America was? Modern architecture, precisely, all these communists that have, communists, imagine me, all these radical architects that have come from Europe, all these emigres that were going to destroy America as we knew it, right? And the example was precisely Mies van der Rohe and the Farnsworth House. Well, at the same time that all the Shelter magazine was doing this, Playboy, in the same year, is celebrating Mies, is celebrating Lakeshore Drive apartment, and it's also celebrating Bucky Fuller, which is, for everything I understood, also neglected in most publications and considered an odd case. But they not only interview him, but publish all his dreams of the city of the future. There are 5,000 living units here, each one of the three phases of this pyramid, with enough space, each one for a little garden, etc. Or you have here Moses Avdi, looking pretty spiffy, and Paolo Soleri, with these fantasies of the future, cathedral cities for a new society. Thousands of independent apartments units are stuck up in a vast science fiction form. The architect stands at the edge of the future, visualizing the possible trajectory of the sign. So the playboy never goes outside, but dreams of flying towards the future in a kind of sealed domestic capsule. The playboy interior finally swallows everything, even his own future. In the end, this continuous expanded wall of the sign is itself a sexual fantasy, to conclude, a space the reader is skillfully seduced into. The more detailed the description, the more intensely the reader desires to get into this world. To subscribe to Playboy is to get a set of keys to a dreamlike world, a magical interior. With its global circulation, and this is interesting too, because when you go to the archives of Bucky Fuller, you see the story the other way around. Not only how much he contributed to Playboy, but how much more he would have liked to contribute to Playboy. So it's just, he had a lot more that he would have liked to have published there and was corresponding with them. In the end, this is a continuous fantasy. Playboy had a massive global circulation, as I say, at its peak in 1972. At its peak, Playboy had 7 million copies, which imagine how many millions of readers is that, maybe 28 million, maybe more. You can argue that it had more influence on architecture, on the dissemination of modern design and architecture, and professional magazines, interior magazines, and even institutions like the Museum of Modern Art. I give you an example. This is 1972. It's the same year that Playboy will reach its peak in readership, 7 million, right? How many people went to the Museum of Modern Art to see this fabulous exhibition of Italian design? This is, by the way, the Malite chair of MATA. Well, maybe 200,000. Those are big numbers for MoMA. Or maybe they were 400,000. But how many saw the new domestic landscape precisely through the pages of Playboy magazine? So any serious study of the diffusion of modern architecture in America has to take Playboy very, very seriously. But again, the key point here is that the sign was not simply featured in the magazine, it was its very mechanism. And of course, you know, and here you have the Malite chair, for example. Here is the Malite chair, as it would have been represented in any other magazine and in Playboy. And here you have the Mies chair of Architum, and here is the Mies chair in Playboy, et cetera, et cetera. And of course, as you could see before with Neutra, architects were readers too. Right, and in a way, it affected their fantasies too. They start presenting themselves as Playboy, as in this great picture of Charles Eames with Sarin, in which both they appear as playboys with their dinner jackets and their farfalline looking. Look at the eyes of Eero Saarinen towards this woman. If Playboy. Let me finish with this little change in the gear. So if Playboy couldn't exist without architecture, I'm now going to go briefly for 5 minutes into demonstrating how architecture couldn't exist without Playboy. The magazine deeply affected the imaginations of critics and architects and historians of architecture, sometimes in a negative sense, like, for example, when Gideon in the fourth edition to his Space, Time, and Architecture, wrote this this new preface, which is called Architecture in the 1960s, Hopes and Fears, where he writes that at the moment a certain confusion exists in contemporary architecture, as in painting, a kind of pause, even a kind of exhaustion. Everybody is aware of it. Fatigue is normally accompanied by uncertainty, what to do and where to go. Fatigue is the mother of indecision, opening the door to escapism, to superficialities of all kinds. Right? And then he goes on to finish here, a kind of Playboy architecture is in vogue, and architecture treated as Playboys treat life, jumping from one sensation to another and quickly bored with everything. Now, this was a little piece inside this this intro, but of course was picked up by all the magazine that immediately called Siegfried Gideon on Playboy architecture, in which he basically rehashed the same thing that he had already written for the introduction, but the introduction is not published yet, in a number of magazines like the Architectural Forum here, or the Deutsche, whatever it's called, Biennale, all these magazines in all over Europe, they call Playboy architecture, and of Gideon, and you can see what Gideon means by Playboy architecture already. Of course, all the architects of the Lincoln Center are Playboy architects. Hugh Stevens and his famous House of the Culture of the Wall in Berlin, a beautiful building, is Playboy architecture. Robert Geddes is Playboy architecture. Edward Darrell Stone and the Brussels Pavilion is all of them. Yamasaki is, of course, a Playboy architect. They are all Playboy architects. Gordon Bushup, Saarinen, all with their pipes, are Playboy architects. And you can, maybe he was right. Maybe there is something about this architecture. There's a lot of sexuality in this architecture. This is, by the way, the TWA terminal and construction. But I want you to present the other side of it, which is very early on, 1960. Rainer Bonham writes this article in the Architects Journal, and I want to show you the cover, or at least the content page of the Architectural Journal, to see what kind of context this is. It's still a very conservative journal. And what does Bonham write there? I will crawl a mile for Playboy, right? And I will crawl a mile for Playboy. Of course, I buy it for the giant fold-out, full-color pin-ups. Playboy playmates are one of America's greatest gifts to Western culture, and you know how I go for culture. But if I was a working hypocrite, and I could find a dozen other reasons for keeping abreast of Playboy, item, architecture, and interior design, I will repeat that to show that I'm not kidding, architecture and interior design. April 7th, 1960. And I found out very late in the research, and I was so astonished that Bonham already has picked up that one could read Playboy for his architecture and interior design. And in fact, he says this, that he buys it for the fold-up, for the pin-ups. But if that there is also a lot of architecture in this, I will repeat to show I'm not kidding, right? But the whole architectural world decided not to look into this, despite of the fact that, you know, in departments of literature, Umberto Eco wrote a book on Playboy. In departments of literature in Ivy League schools, they take very seriously the literature that was in Playboy. People in histories of ideas, all the interviews of Marx and McLuhan, they are famous in Playboy. All the, you know, so why is it that as architects we decided not to look at this material? But it's interesting to me that for us may have been obscure, but for that generation was very clear. By the way, Bonham was among the ones that was also constantly writing letters to Playboy. For example, here he's praising some piece of literature he has read, his appreciation for the Elrich Kleber, the flashlight, and one, he says, of a growing number of Europeans who find themselves in a state of baffle admiration for the city of angels, and I'm just finishing a book on Angeleno architecture and human ecology, blah, blah, blah. So he's basically pondering his book, and at the end he writes Mr. Bonham is a prominent English architect, writer, author of the well-tempered architectural environment. So he's fully aware that this is 7 million copies, which is many millions of readers, and he plants this little letter there, in case. But in case you thought that he is alone, of course he uses Playboys in his publications. This is Bonham again, his Triumphs of Software, along with Barbarella, etc. But the point I want to get to is that all that generation was the Playboy generation. For example, Hans Holheim, you know, when he was doing Bau magazine, we interviewed him for the Klippestand Fall exhibition, actually Craig Buckley did. And he told us this great story of how Bau was a really boring professional magazine in Austria. And he had complained to the director of the Association of Architects of Austria in one of these cocktail parties and told him that the magazine was the same. And he said, why don't you do it? And now he had to do it. And to do it, he starts by going to Moscow and interviewing Melnikov. And he wanted to do a special issue of Melnikov. But things were so difficult in Moscow at the time, he said, that at a certain point I realized we couldn't reproduce the images that he had given us. Everything was a complication. So I thought, I put all the images of Melnikov in a suitcase, I take them to Vienna, I make the reproductions, and then I come back and return. And he's telling us this Cold War story, and I'm already nervous of what is going to happen, because then he describes coming back and how they gave him a hard time in the costumes, and then the guards confiscated, and I thought to myself, oh my God, confiscated the photographs of Melnikov. And they didn't confiscate the photograph of Melnikov. He says, no, no, they confiscated my Playboys. They confiscated your what? Your Playboy. He had to repeat it 3 times. And then, of course, I realized, of course he was reading Playboy, right? I mean, and the guards also were more interested in the Playboy than in these photographs of Melnikov, who cares, right? I mean, so they confiscated, and which is something that you, of course, see. Once you know this, you start seeing the interiors of Bau and all these things, and you know that how much he was influenced by Playboy. Likewise, you can think about Archigram, who had a Playboy in the survival kit of 1963, along with the Valium pills and the music and all these other things. You have to have a Playboy in your shelter. By the way, typical shelters in America also have Scrabble and Valium and Playboys. You know, you have to do something over there. And this is also interesting because in many ways, Playboy is a product of the Cold War. And this is my last thought here. Already in the first issue, Hefner wrote that Playboy was offered as a diversion from the anxieties of the atomic age. And when we did a little bit of research, we find, of course, that the playmates were lining the interior of all the walls of the Kunset huts. And there were many cartoons in the magazines, like this one that says, but I'm sure that was only thunder, Mr. Putnam. Or this other one that says that if we were attacked, Mrs. Jennings, there is room in my shelter for you, but not for the other neighbors. So Playboy is clearly a product of the Cold War. Not only was a part of the world, but it's also present in many famous films of that period, like Doctor Strangelove of 1964 or Apocalypse Now of 1979. I've managed to lose my last page. Okay. Here it is. No, it's not. Okay, so it's fine. I just wanted to conclude the world that. So, in conclusion, from the furniture to the clothes to the lighting to the music, the food, the drinks, the conversation, the jokes, the ideas, the art, the architecture, the smells, and even the way to move, to act, everything was provided by Playboy. It's really a lifestyle magazine, the first lifestyle magazine. In that sense, you can argue that the magazine created a total work of art. When you open the pages of the magazine, you are invited to dive into this world without gaps, without cracks, without decay, an infinite perfected interior a total work of art. Thank you very much.